Hey, good afternoon. Scott Baker here. Hey, you're probably a little bit surprised. Typically, we've been starting out with a song. We will have a song. It's going to be a little bit later. And we're going to do something a little bit different with a song this week than we've done before. But anyways, good to see you this this Wednesday. Sunshine outside, a lot of people going back to work. But welcome to our fifth session of Leading Between. And just a reminder what Leading Between means. It's, you know, we're going to go through different seasons of life. And the question isn't that we'll go through them, it's how that we'll go through them. And do we lead and grow well through them? Last night I was with a group of men and the question of difficulty came up. And the comment I made was, you know, the thing about difficulty is difficulty has a way of finding its way to you. Either you bring it on to yourself or other people bring it on to you. But regardless, difficulty will find its way to you. And then how do you respond when difficulty finds you? I'm dressed a little bit different today. Since we have a Division I basketball coach who's won a couple of national championships, I figured I'm going to like dress so he can put me in coach, right? I played at Central Michigan. It seems like most of my stuff has shrunk. Don't know why. Overdried it, but most of my stuff has shrunk. So I'm wearing something from a school that my son's going to go to at Hope College. Now, a couple things seem to happen each week when we do these sessions. You know, we do the song and stuff, but I get comments from my friends. And one of the comments I get from my friends that is consistent is about this basketball that's over my shoulder that I'm pointing at. So I'll get comments like, great song, get rid of the ball. Like your shirt, get rid of the ball. So one of my friends took it to a little bit of extreme this week. And so he had made a comment like that. So he actually dropped off a game ball for me today. And it actually works for me. So let me show you the game ball that I'm now going to be putting up on my shelf. This is a Hope College soccer ball. This is where my son's going to go play. And so I'm not going to replace my Michigan ball. So I'm just going to put it up on my shelf. So now I'm going to hear stuff from my Kelvin friends and from my Michigan State friends about what I now have with this different ball up on my shelf. Today's topic is we're going to talk about culture. We're going to talk about culture, and we're going to talk about team building and leadership. And most of us in leadership know that culture can either be built by design, with intent, on really good foundation, or culture can just kind of evolve by itself. One of them creates really good fruit. The other one, well, let's just say it creates difficulty for us. And the guest that we have today is Donnie Jones. I'll share with you how I met Donnie, and we'll get Donnie involved here in a little bit. But Donnie has been part of some interesting cultures. One is he was the assistant head coach to Billy Donovan at one point, where they won two national championships at the University of Central Florida. He'll tell you he got robbed of a third one when they played Michigan State, Mateen Cleave. So depending on your perspective, Spartans seem to think it went well. He thinks he got robbed. He's been at Marshall. He spent some time at University of Central Florida, where he got to coach Michael Jordan's sons. So he got some interesting teachings there. Today, he's at Stetson University, where he's the men's varsity basketball coach. And he's taken on an assignment there where he's turning around a culture that didn't win much at all. And so what's really neat about him is he'll give us some stories on what's it like to be at programs that are winning well. What's it like to rebuild something? Now, one of the things I like about Donnie a ton is, regardless of title, regardless of program, he gets it. His assignment is always the same. That assignment is to build men. So regardless of where he goes, his assignment is to build men. And that's how he leads. And so excited for you to meet him in a little bit and learn more about what he's learned from the coaching's ranks. Now, last week to this week, if you remember last week's topic, we talked about resiliency, and there was a couple of themes that resonated with people that have gotten back with me on them. One was, if you remember Justin's football, so he had this kind of football in the middle, and he said you need six key relationships to help develop resiliency. And on the top, he said professionals. He had a coach, right? You know, a trainer and a boss. And underneath, He had friends and he had mentors and he had counselors. And so I've talked to a number of men about this topic. And the conversations went something like this. All I have is a boss. I don't have the other five. All I have is a boss. And so, yeah, next up, get a mentor. But something else we talked about was, why do you only have a boss? And where the conversation went something like this. If your life is centered on you, and it's about how you manipulate your environment or how you try and get something, you likely aren't going to have people like that in your life because it's about you. When you realize that life is just this huge, cool story that you get to play a part in, and it's not about you, and you start listening different, and you start seeing things differently, what I shared with them is that God has already put in place the people that you need in your life. You just can't see them and you can't hear them because you're just thinking about you. I'll give you an example. This is how I met Donnie. Donnie and I prayed for the same thing on the same day, on the same flight as we left from Orlando to Atlanta. Now, we didn't know each other. I'm an aisle seater. He was a late booker. So he's got the middle row or the middle seat. So my guess is his prayer went something like, Lord God, don't put me next to some knuckleheads on the left and the right. My prayer was, don't put anybody in the middle seat. But if you do, have it be somebody that's a bit interesting. And so when I fly, I'm going to ask you a question. And so when Donnie sat down, I noticed a couple things. One, he had really cool sneakers. He had some really cool Nike sneakers. I hadn't seen them before. He had some cool Nike coach's pants on. And so I looked at him, same thing I always do. I said, you're from Orlando or you're from Atlanta? He goes, I'm from Orlando, going to Atlanta. Okay, what are you going to Atlanta for? And then it got interesting. I would learn he's a Clippers scout working with Doc Rivers. I'm a basketball guy. And then he was meeting with some people about future jobs and coaching. And so we started a conversation. 4 years later, Donnie Jones is a friend of mine. I've been able to watch him on TV as he's coaching. We stay in contact with each other. And one of the cool things he did for me is he came up to Grand Rapids, Michigan. He spoke at our company. And then he came to my home. And I had a bunch of freshman kids, a bunch of freshman basketball players, and their dads. And he blessed them. And it was just so neat for him to give of his time to bless those kids was just really, really rich stuff. Now, I'll have him share something that happened in the basement later, but my ears are open, my eyes are looking, and I'm looking to see how my day can get interrupted. And I'm looking for people that are trying to grow in their life like I am. And that wasn't an accident that he was sitting next to me. And so it's just been cool to have the friendship that we have over the last 4 years. So if you're missing a friend, if you're missing those, start thinking about yourself a little bit or a little bit less about yourself. The next one that came up was, is my life a good read? So I had folks talk to me about that. I said, is my life a good read? You know, are other people's lives better because they intersect with mine? That's troubling for some. That's a good lead in to the books I'm going to recommend for this week. One of them is by Donald Miller. It's called A Million Miles in 1,000 Years. It's about Donald Miller writing a movie about his life story. So this is kind of funny. Here's the first page in it. And let me tell you, is your life like this or do you know people like this? Says, if you watched a movie about a guy who wanted a Volvo and worked for years to get it, you wouldn't cry at the end when he drove off the lot testing the windshield wipers. You wouldn't recommend it. You wouldn't go see it. Truth is, you wouldn't remember the movie. Here. But we spend years actually living those stories and expect our lives to feel meaningful. The truth is, if what we choose to do with our lives won't make a story meaningful, it won't make a life meaningful either. Wow. That's quite a way to open a book, but it's a really good read. It's funny, but there's some really good self-reflection in that book. Second one I have for you, Tattoos on the Heart. Really cool read. We have a, it's a pastor, Gregory Boyle, finds his way, he's a Jesuit priest, finds his way to LA in the Watts area. And what he does, he builds a company called Homeboy Industries. And he gives a bunch of young people purpose. He gives a meaning. And it's just a tattoos on the heart. And it's about putting a tattoo literally on your heart. The name's Jesus. It's a tremendous read. We've read this one as a team. Last one, this is a little bit bigger read. If you haven't seen this one, it's Abraham Lincoln, Team of Rivals. And if you think of Lincoln, what he did, what a tough time to lead. But what he did is he put on his team the bad guys, if you will. He had on his cabinet, he intentionally put on his cabinet, people that didn't like him, people that didn't share his values, people that were for slavery, people that were for South and North. He put them on his team. Talk about leadership and strength and courage. Can you imagine Donald Trump having Nancy Pelosi on his team? Breathe that one in for a second. But it's a tremendous read, tremendous read. So those are three for you for this week. So I'm gonna pray. And then what I'm gonna do is we're gonna go to our song and then we're gonna invite Donnie in. So these are some of the things that are on my heart this morning, folks, as we start. I said, well, I just thanks for sunshine. It seems when there's sunshine outside, you know, there's just people just a little bit more sunshine in their heart. What I prayed for is, can I just be sunshine in the absence of rain in someone else's life today? I said, thank you for, I get to see my grandkids today. Okay, I haven't hugged them in a long time, but I get to see my granddaughters today. I said, thank you for undeserved blessings and family and business, my parents. We've got really good customers. I thanked them for customers. The health and safety of our people. Just thanked him for that. I said, I need some help. There's a lot of hurt going on. How do you use me to help those who are hurting? I said, Lord, guide my mind, my thoughts, my ears, my words, and my steps today. Move me where you need me to go. I prayed to be present. Okay. This is a struggle. Being present's tough for me. You know, I just have so many things going on at home in my head. My wife called me on that recently, fairly. But man, just help me be present wherever I am. And focus. Keep me focused. Help me stay focused. For you, I said just one thing, just one takeaway today, just one takeaway. And then the courage to act on it. The courage to stand firm. The courage to seek out and be the truth. I prayed that we're all good friends and that we surround ourselves with what I call truth tellers. I just prayed that any stress, anxiety that exists today as we watch this, no presence here. Just command God, take it away. Just take it away. It has no presence here. Pray to use all of us. Just thanked him for the gift of his son, Jesus, his unmatched name. We all prayed, amen. So we're gonna go to the song. And here's what I'd like you to do. So this is a participation song, okay? So what I'd like you to do, get out a piece of paper. On the left side of the paper, you're gonna write left, okay, left. And what's gonna be under left are gonna be the words and phrases that catch you as you hear this song. On the right side of your piece of paper, I want you thinking about the words and phrases that caught your eye, caught your ear, and I want you to ask yourself really quick, does this word or phrase describe me? Does it describe me? Now, I might really like that word and that phrase, but truth be told, am I that or am I not that? Particularly in times of trial. I want you to do the same thing for your team. So those are just quick check marks. And then for Donnie and I, we have a chat function. If there's a word or phrase, so I'm asking you to do a lot of things at the same time. That's that focus challenge I've got. If there's a word or phrase that hits you, just hit us with it. Man, I like that word. Boom, I like this. Okay? So use the song to learn. And I think you're going to recognize the song.
stood there boldly, sweating in the sun. Felt like a million, felt like number one. The height of summer, I never felt that strong, like a rock.
Yep. Wait, I gotta stop it though. I thought we already did that. Hey guys, apparently I didn't cue this up right. We're gonna restart it. Yeah, but I don't know if I got back to the beginning. Okay.
Stood there boldly, sweating in the sun. Felt like a million, felt like number one. The height of summer, I'd never felt that strong, like a rock. I was 18, didn't have a care. Working for peanuts, not a dime to spare. But I was leaning, solid everywhere, like a rock. My hands were steady, my eyes were clear and bright. My walk had purpose, my steps were quick and light. And I held firm to what I felt was right, like a rock, like a rock. I was strong as I could be, like a rock. Nothing ever got to me, like a rock. I was something to see.
Good stuff. Like a Rock. Bob Seger wrote that song. And if you know the history about this, behind the song a little bit, he wrote the song for Chevy. And it was supposed to be about their truck platform. But as he wrote it, he really wrote it to be very introspective about his own life. And if you go to the back end of this song, what he talks about is he looks back 20 years ago, and he wonders where it went. He wonders where it went. But some of the words that are in this song are going to tie into what Donnie's going to talk about in building culture. Right out of the gates, stood there boldly. Do you stand there boldly? Does your team stand there boldly? Later on, if you look at the first two stanzas, it feels like he's talking about his body, which he is, but then he switches it on us and he then starts talking about his soul and his heart. His hands are steady, eyes are clear and bright. His walk has purpose. Do you have purpose? Do you have purpose? Your team have purpose? Your company have purpose? What's it like to follow a leader whose eyes are clear and bright and not tired? Steps quick and firm, held on firmly to what he knew was right. Firmly. And then in the next one I talk about, I love, I said, he says, I was encumbered by the weight of the hustlers and their schemes. I stood proud. I stood tall. I stood above it all. And he still held on to his dreams. It's a terrific song. So take a look at your words. What did you check? What didn't you check? And give that some thought as we turn our attention now to Donnie. Because, you know, as he and I have unpacked this song, we've talked about the words here that are so important in building culture and building leadership and building teams. So Donnie, how you doing?
Doing good, Scott.
Good to see you. Yeah, we were commiserating a little bit about the song. Now, you're in a spot right now as a D1 coach, and we'll get to these words in a second, but you're apart from your kids. So how do you stay connected with kids, build that culture, build that teaming thing when you're away from your kids? And you've only been at Stetson second year, right?
Started my second year, been here 1 year. So we were getting year two, almost.
Good to see you. So how are you doing?
Yeah, I'm good. I'm good, Scott. So great to be with you. And obviously, listen to that song. I used to have a Chevy Impala, a blue one. That was my first car. So
yeah,
that was back in my day. So a great song.
Outstanding.
But, we are good, and we're excited about what we're doing here. I'm excited to be a part of what you're doing. And it's been great to be a part of this leadership group that you have here. And thanks for having us today.
Yeah, it's just a privilege to have you on. So today with your kids, how do you stay connected and get culture? Because you're apart from them.
Yeah, well, it's a different time. And I think it's the most important thing we always talk about, Scott, is communication. You know, how do we communicate? And I think when we came here and to build a program and walked into a place, I hadn't won for 20 plus years, hadn't had a winning season. And so how do we implement winning, and how do we build a culture just more than just wins, but also building people? And so with that, you know, during this time here, as we brought in a lot of new people after we evaluated what we were going to do. And I think this year, you know, this has come up. And so it's been a time here now from a leadership standpoint, put basketball aside, and, you know, how do we help these young people during this time and not feeling isolated and going through a lot of fears anytime there's a crisis that comes around?
Yeah. What are you finding is the biggest challenge for you as a coach and with the young people during this time?
Yeah, well, I think the biggest thing is they haven't been isolated. You know, they're used to being out. They're sociable people. Our kids are, and they're not used to just being locked in the house. And I think that's been the hard thing for them. You know, sports and we teach how to communicate. We teach how to be a partner. We teach how to be a team. We'll talk a little bit about huddle in a little bit. We talk about all those things, and now we've just had to come to a stop. So it's important to listen to them a lot. We try to be the best communicative team in the country. We're doing a lot of Zoom calls and a lot of one-on-one calls, a lot of group calls, and I just try to communicate as much as I can.
You know, when you walked in this, you're taking over a program, and us as leaders, as businesses, we walk into those same kind of situations where maybe there isn't a culture of you know, feeling good about yourself, and win-loss records are one of those things that we measure ourselves with. You have an interesting way that you shared with me on how you just get to know your kids and begin building this culture. Could you share that with the listeners?
I can. And I think that's important, Scott. It's important to understand your why and why you do what you do, who we are. And I think with that, you want those kids to buy in from an ownership standpoint. And the most important thing in bringing your team together is for us to get to know who we are individually. The beautiful thing about teams and in sports and doing this for 30 plus years, you got people from all around the world, all different cultures and backgrounds like ourselves. And how do we get to know each other? And so we kind of got this process. We call it the five H's, which I think is really powerful. And we start off and we have each player stand up and they share about a minute and a half or 2 minutes of the first one being heritage. Where are you from? You kind of tell your story. Where it began for you, where you grew up, your parents, your brothers, your sisters, important people in your life, and just to kind of where you are now. And then the second thing we come back and the question we ask for them is we talk about who's your hero? Who do you look up to? Who's your mentor? Who's somebody that's been impactful in your life? Who's somebody you model yourself after? And then the third one that we come back and we talk about, which is really one of the toughest ones, and this one's the one that really brings the group together, is what's your heartbreak? The third H, heartbreak. And so heartbreak is just, as we get older, we have a lot more heartbreaks because we have more time. But young people, it's interesting to hear what's been a heartbreak to them. And so they share that third H. And then we come back with the fourth one being, what's a highlight? Scott, we want to come back with a positive, what's been a highlight in your life. And it also lets us know what they value. And then the last one, which is an important one, is what's your hope? What is your plan? What's your legacy? What's life look like for you? What do you vision? And so with it, that gives us a chance to really get a feel of who they are, what's their why. And then together we set, and we also find out we've all been broken. We've all had tough times. We've all had great highlights, and I get to know your story, and it makes me understand maybe your personality a little different, but also it gives me a connection with you as we grow as brothers, because brotherhood, we'll talk about in a little bit, is an important value for us in our culture.
And you had mentioned to me before, so it's not just going through the answers, which are interesting. It's why, you know, what's the depth of someone's hero? Is it a comic book hero, or is it something deeper than that?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Highlight something that feels a little bit superficial, or is it something that, and so you're looking for that when the kids speak.
And we are, and you know, and sometimes we've had to coach some kids because when they're new, especially as freshmen, and we do this every year. So you'll do this four times, because if there's one person new on your team, and that's from the coaches to our managers, everybody involved in our basketball family. And it starts with me. As the leader, you're the example. They need to see me be authentic and real as we try to build trust. And it's important that we, as leaders, teach them who their hero should probably be, because sometimes they may say Michael Jordan, because, you know, he's our favorite basketball player. But I'm like, well, did Michael Jordan come and take care of you when you were sick? Did Michael Jordan feed you and take you to school every day? Oh, no, that was my mom or my grandma. Okay, well, you need to understand, and that would be a private conversation. But I think it's important for them to identify, as you were mentioning early, who their circle is.
Yeah.
Who is their circle? Do we appreciate and recognize the people that's in our circle?
Yeah, and that gives you some sense for who's speaking into their life.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So it's a great trust builder, Scott, as we go through, and I've seen some incredible transformations from kids just through this exercise.
Well, I think it's a pretty clear, we were joking a little bit, you say, I have to cap it at 2 minutes because some of these kids will just run it at the mouth, and then you have the other kids that will only do 30 seconds.
Absolutely.
And so, but I really liked how you start that, because, you know, everyone has a story, and you're coaching them up on, one, be proud of your story, and be able to tell it, where are you from? You know, who shaped you? And then what are your hopes and dreams? And so just real quickly, you're teaching them about life and stories. You also mentioned that in terms of building trust, we talked about questions last week too, but you said as you build trust, the questions start coming in the other way.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So, you know, a lot of things we do now is a lot of one-on-ones, Zoom calls. So it's a great time to spend time with our players, and I've got to know them differently. And so building trust, I think there's three things that go to that. Mm-hmm. Number one is obviously time, putting time in, investing. You know, a lot of people's, we've heard this many times, nobody cares how much you know till they know how much you care.
Yeah.
And it's so vital to build trust, because so many kids today walk through the door without fathers, with people that's been in their life because they've been superstars and they've cheered for them for the fame. But how many have really invested in them as people because they really care and love about them? And then the next thing we talk about, just really being consistent, Scott. You just got to be consistency. Just somebody that's consistent message of really who you are from an emotional standpoint. And then the third thing is really just over time, just proof. Do your words match up with your actions of who you really are? And, you know, I always used to heard this many times, you can't fool dogs and you can't fool players. They know. All right, if you're telling them the truth most of the time, all right? So it's important that you're able to communicate with them, because a lot of people communicate, but very few connect. The five H's help us connect.
Yeah.
There's a difference.
So explain from your perspective, what's the difference between communicating and connecting?
Yeah, well, connecting is being able to reach the heart. I try to lead by touching the heart before I reach out with the hand. And the connecting is being able to speak truth, not lecture to them, but really listen to them, being really to add value to them. And it begins with them. And I think so many people today, especially as leaders, we go with the title, as you well know. And it's not really what our title is. It's what we do and how we use our title. And I think that's what kids are looking. They're looking to be a part of something. They got this invisible sign that goes around their neck that I belong. I want to be a part. And it's there with every kid. All of us have it. We all want to be loved. We all want to be a part of something bigger than ourselves. But a lot of times we just don't know how to do it and how to be a part. So we share a lot of stories. And then trust is just built over time. And I think you got to continue to be straightforward and authentic with who and each and every one of these players are.
You were sharing with me that with your kids, you got, is it 13 scholarships or 12 scholarship athletes this year?
13.
So 13 scholarship athletes. You have a journal for each one of your players.
Mm-hmm. I do.
Explain why you have a journal for each player.
Yeah, so we give each player a journal, and they have an opportunity, just like this right here. We have people come and speak to them. We have a 12-month leadership program where we're constantly bringing the right voices. We call voices and choices. You know, the voices you hear are usually the choices that you make. And I think that we really talk about our circle, and we talk about how do we grow. And I think in that growth standpoint, we write it down in a journal. You know, I have my journal right here. My daughter made said fear is a liar on the outside of it. And so with that, it's as I go through here, you can see all the different things that we've done over time where you're journaling and we're teaching them how to write things down. If something matters in life, we always talk about it. We usually forget about 80% of what we go through during the day. So we talk about that. And then it also shows respect for other people when we're writing. And we teach our guys to ask questions. Yeah. Scott, you know, it's easy to listen, but to be fully engaged and to learn to ask analytical questions is also a talent that also helps teach kids how to communicate.
Yeah, because with all this, iPhone, smartphone stuff today, having an adult conversation, looking someone in the eye can be a challenge.
It can be. And a lot of them have never been told and have never been asked to do that. And it's so vital. For them as they move, out of college. You know, we try to take them as boys and 4 years make them men. And I think that's important to how it impacts the next 45, 50 years of life.
We talked about this huddle thing that you use. So explain what the huddle means to Donnie and what the huddle means to your team and building culture.
Absolutely. Being a part of great teams, Scott, we talk about it all the time. It's one of our strategies. And one of our strategies is how we huddle. And our huddle is obviously they're able to make the correlation to sports because we have timeouts. Some could be 30 seconds, some could be a minute 30. And during that time, they got to be able to focus in, they got to be able to listen, and they got to be able to hear the message, the adjustment, or the encouragement, or whatever it may be at the time to make the needed adjustment for the situation. So how we huddle in wins, how we huddle in losses, how we huddle through any adversity or anything is very vital in life. And Scott, I know we've had this conversation before, numerous times. And I was, when we were sitting on that plane, I think this is one that stood out to me. You had an incredible insight as well on how you huddle.
Yeah, we huddle at our company. I shared with Donnie that in our quarterly meetings, we start with a huddle and the origins of the huddle actually came from our barn ministry where, we'd lock arms and shoulders as men in a huddle before we'd start an evening of fellowship. And it's a fairly intimate way. I think a huddle, Donnie, in sports is probably the most intimate thing that happens in sports. It's you get to come in and say, I belong here. You can count on me. I've got your back. You can correct me. I'm doing all the work off season. I've earned the right to be in the huddle. And so, it's kind of it's a privilege to be in a huddle.
It really
is very affirming and welcoming. And so we do that. We've been doing it for, 10 years plus at our company. And it's pretty meaningful to us and to our team.
Well, we've said this many times about the huddle, Scott. It doesn't matter. We got kids from six different countries. Everybody's from a different place. But when you get in that huddle and you're locked up with your hands, nobody really cares about where you're from, if you're black, white, Asian, really don't care. It's all about the purpose together, the common goal of what we're trying to accomplish, which is the beauty of brotherhood.
Yeah. You sent me an interesting picture a little bit ago, and it was a picture of 12 books, 12 or 13, however many kids you had on the team last year. And each one was different. You go, these are the books we read last summer.
Yes.
explain why there were 12. Yep. And they're good stuff. And I shared mine back. I go, I got that one. I got that one. I got that. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, at the time we had 12 players, so that made 12 books. And so what we did as a summer is, you know, when I first got there, the first thing you do when you take a program, you evaluate. And I really tried to personally interview other people about kids because everybody was new to me and I was new to them. And so with that, I tried to get a real feel of what I thought they needed. And so with that, I took books because I'm an avid reader as well as you. And I tried to match up a book that I thought really lined up with something that was a void or something could grow the individual. So I had signed a book that I've read that I thought fit them. And so when that happened, they would read that book, they'd come back in and they would sit down with me and we would have a meeting and they would tell me what they learned. I'd have some questions from it of what they learned from it and what they seen. And then we would give them a chance to get in front of our leadership group, which we call Hats Off. We're the Stetson Hatters. So it's a Hats Off is our term for our leadership program once a week. So with that, we don't talk basketball ever during that time. It's strictly about life and about things that we can grow as men. And during that time, they would share their story, another chance to talk about grit, talk about resiliency, whatever books they may have read, why the best are the best. You know, they shared the story from what they read with others, which has more power when you have your players sharing it than it does yourself.
Yeah, you know, it's just, so cool that, when we connected, I tell folks, how'd you get connected so-and-so? Well, the Jesus in me connected with the Jesus in him. And you're just comfortable with each other.
Sure.
And, I'm going to say it again. One of the things there's many things I admire about you, Donnie, but one of them is each of us and you have been given a platform, if you will.
Absolutely.
To really develop young people. Mm-hmm. To become men and not just use them to get something for you, which could be a better record or another assignment someplace else. Mm-hmm. And I've really admired you because there are people in my world and in your world that don't look at it that way.
Absolutely.
It's how do I get where I want to get to the next job?
Well, I've been blessed, Scott. I've had a lot of people. I'm a product of a lot of people loving me from all the different parts of my career and my steps. I've learned from some incredible leaders, that have all my stops who have always pointed in the direction, obviously, of using this platform as a legacy to grow people. People never forget how you make them feel and during their time. Obviously, winning's important, but how do we win, I think, at the end of the day? And that's really the process, and we talk about that. We talk about what winning does in the platform. It gives you a bigger platform for more opportunity to impact other people. Yeah. And so I think that's been the thing I've been fortunate. I've seen what right is. I had to choose it. I think you got choices that you always make, but I think that I've been fortunate to choose that path to really help people.
You were on a special run with your friend Billy, over at Florida. Mm-hmm. Back-to-back national championships, which is not an easy thing to do. That's just not special coaching and special players. That's a pretty special system.
Yes.
Invite us into what was present during those days at Florida with both the staff that you guys had built and your players.
Yes. And, there's a lot of things. I think the biggest thing is we walked into a football school, Scott, right off, into four NCAA tournaments in 80 years. Four times. We walked into a place that we needed to try to, one, create an atmosphere of expectation. And I use this a lot, and I didn't get this from Billy, but he always created a mindset of expectations. We created them. Even though they didn't have any set, we created them for them. And so, we always have a mantra that I use here now saying, be there before you get there. And I think we created that mindset with our players and the type of people that we recruited. And we valued people, number one. We valued people, first of all. How we built trust, how we celebrated them. And, love was not a term that wasn't afraid to be used. It was used every day. We love tough instead of tough love. And there's different ways to coach. But those players knew we cared about them. They bought in. You got to believe in before you have buy-in. And life. and there was incredible belief in, and it became a process where we were able to, you know, I sent this out the other day. It's amazing that the amount of people, but you know, there's three types of teams. You know, there's an average team. And I mean, a team that hardly ever does anything because nobody leads, you know, and then you got a little bit of above average team that's usually coach led. And then you have elite teams that's player led. We become a player led culture because of the habits and the day to day things that we were able to do and the success we had. And it came down with the people. Obviously, our leader didn't care who got the credit. He had incredible humility, celebrated everybody was a part of the program. Coaches had incredible chemistry as well. The people around were speaking the same language that he was speaking. And, you know, some of our languages, you know, like family for us, you know, different cultures have their own language, you know. Forget about me, I love you. You know, that was a big thing we would say in family. So we got our own mantra and it became a legacy of something that was bigger than us all. And when people start serving, giving, and not caring who gets the credit, we talk about that, it becomes magical and energy gets created.
Remind us who some of your players were, where they were drafted in the draft.
Sure.
And why they came back.
Mm-hmm. Well, that run, that was incredible. We were the third team only in college basketball history to have back-to-back national championships. And so the year of 2006 is pretty remarkable. You know, we was picked dead last in the SEC coming in. People forget. We weren't even the top 200 team in the country preseason. And we came back with four sophomores and obviously rallied and went all the way and won a national championship. We came back preseason number one. All those kids came back. And after we won that first national championship, after the celebrations quit, you know, come the day after, as you like to say, Scott, of what's next, because opportunity, as you have success, as we always say, as the tide rises, all boats float, right? Yeah. Well, opportunity came knocking for everybody. I had opportunities as a head coach. A lot of assistants had opportunities as head coaches. Players had a chance to go to the NBA draft. So they had to make some choices that was, and all of them had to be what was right for their situation and their family. 24 hours later, it wasn't a day went by. All three of the top players who were top 10 draft picks, all three of them, Corey Brewer, Joe Kim Noah, Al Horford, all had a chance to go make millions and millions of dollars. And so the day went by. They walked into coach's office together, not one by one, together. I said, Coach, we just want you to know we're not finished here. We got more to do. We believe in you. We got more room to grow as people. We're not ready to walk into a locker room right now with men. And we want to enjoy this moment because we know that this is a special time. And so with that, that year become a different challenge because as we well know, the path up the mountaintop that we got there the first time was completely different, with incredible hurdles to get there again, Scott. And so to be able to win back to back with the pressure and the expectations that we had never had before was remarkable.
I'm going to ask one more question, then just open up to questions for the panelists. So so your run ended at Florida. You end up at University of Central Florida,
mm-hmm.
and you have two players on your team with familiar last names.
Yeah, absolutely.
So what was it like running a practice with Michael in the stands?
Well, that's true pressure. you know, I got the job. When I got it, Marcus was a freshman, and Jeffrey was not there at the time. Yeah. So I was coaching. I had to always recruit the players. When you first get the job, you worry who will transfer because you didn't recruit them. Mm-hmm. But I'm very close to Marcus, and I coached Marcus for a year. And Michael calls me on the phone and says, hey, Coach, I'd love to bring Jeffrey there, and I'll pay for it, and I'd love for him to be there with you and Marcus. So Jeffrey came, and so I had a chance to really coach him, and it was a really neat time. Obviously, Michael would show up and ask, hey, is it okay if I just sit in the corner and watch practice? And you know, what are you going to tell the greatest of all time? No, Mike, you can't come to practice. We got it locked up. But it was really cool. He sat there and obviously was incredible in practice, smiling, was very complimentary. Set him in office for a couple hours many times. And it was really neat to see Michael Jordan, the dad, Scott. Mm. You know what I mean? He's as competitive as he is. He's also like us as fathers. He loves his sons. He loves his family. He'd do anything for him. He's very supportive of him. And during this time, obviously, as a player, he had so much notoriety with so many expectations away from home that he was, you know, putting that time in now later on in those years to support his boys. And but always wanted the best for them, never wanted any favorable favors. He wanted them held accountable. He wanted them pushed the hardest. His competitive spirit never changed in how he was coaching me to coach his kids, and which was pretty cool.
Yeah, we've seen a little bit on the Last Dance piece of it with his competitive spirit. So
absolutely.
A question that we have is, it's can you describe love tough versus tough love? So what did that mean to your program?
Yeah. So tough love sometimes is we think that we got to be able to just be hard on them, boss them, be transactional, demand from them. And love tough means, first of all, is they know I care about you. I've built trust. I've built up equity. I've shouted praise and whispered criticism. Okay. It's important through the five H's. I learned who you were and how I could coach you. Being able to coach great players is you got to know how to communicate with them. You got to know how to not embarrass people and be able to get the best out of people. So love tough means we love you first. And that could be some one-on-one meetings. That could be how I approach you is differently. How I celebrate you is differently. And tough love is just flat out just demanding and punishing to me. And I think that if you got to be careful with today's kids is because a lot of them aren't getting coached when you get them. And now you're trying to hold them accountable. So how do you hold them accountable and keep trust and be able to get them to see the why? They got to know the why today. If you're not sharing the why, back in our day, we did as we were told. Today, they can Google it and figure it out on their own before they ask you as a coach. It's incredible.
Okay. Another question was, does everyone tell their story to the team, or do they just sit down and tell you the story?
Everybody tells it to the team. That's the power in your story. It's because we all own it now. And so our job as a team and a brother is to be able to know your story and be able to support your story. So I should be sensitive to certain things that may be a heartbreak to you. And also, I'm trying to help you get your hope, whatever your vision is. So I talk about each one of these and what they mean and why. All right. Cause that's so important to share with the team.
Okay. You had a player at University of Central Florida that you'd recruited, that was recently on 60 Minutes, Taco. Mm-hmm. Some of the folks are going to know this man. Explain who Taco is. We saw him get way too many fouls called on him against Duke. So a little bit about Taco's background and how does this guy end up on 60 Minutes?
Yeah, this guy's an incredible story. I'll give it to you as quick as I can, but I met him going in his 10th grade year. He moved to a small Christian high school right outside of Orlando, Florida. A friend of mine called and said, there's this 7'4" kid. I'm going to bring him to your game tonight. And I'm like, okay, sure. He's probably 6'11". Guys are usually about 4 or 5 inches smaller. So before the game, my high school coaching friend walks through the door. And I'm sitting at my desk upstairs in my office, and this large person walks in, and he has to bend down, and he's completely down, and he rises up, and I'll never forget. I just got up on my desk and walked over and said, wow, it is great to meet you, Taco. Sit down. So Taco was 7'4" then. He grew to 7'6". Our relationship began in the 10th grade, and I was the first to offer him a scholarship. But we had many conversations, Scott, but the most beautiful thing about Taco is we talked about two things with Taco in his recruitment. He had 100 high major offers at the end of the day, and he chose Central Florida, UCF at the time, and he could have went anywhere in America and played. And it really came down to trust. And we talked about being a global leader, how he could impact his community someday, and obviously getting his degree to be an engineer. And so basketball was his third love. God had given him this gift of a 7'6" body. And we just talked about what are we going to do with that gift? He didn't give you that gift to play basketball. All right. Even though that's what you do, that's not who you are. And so with that, we had some beautiful conversations. His story could be 10 times bigger than The Blind Side. If you got any movie producers out there with his journey. And it's remarkable. When you talk about resiliency, Taco falls that times 5 with who he is. He respects everybody. He loves unconditionally. He blames no one. He's grateful for everything. He takes a picture with every stranger in America with incredible patience. And he is going to be a success, and people just gravitate towards him because of his kindness. He's the kindest. He's the gentle giant. And he's got an incredible mind, beautiful, smart, intelligent. My son's birthday, that was the first call at 8 o'clock in the morning. He wakes my son up. It's Taco. Hello, Isaac. You know, happy birthday. How are you? You know, he doesn't forget. And so he'll be a success in life. Basketball, if it takes him anywhere else he needs to go, it's a platform for him to go back and impact his country. And he's doing it in big ways right now.
So how does he end up on 60 Minutes?
He ends up on 60 Minutes, Scott. That's the story. Just because of the whole process of a lot of these kids coming from Africa, where he come from in Senegal, how they're brought over, the people that's involved with them. And there's so many of them dumped off all over America that people don't know how they got here. And some of them struggle. And what is the story, and who are the people behind these kids? And so he's really on there trying to help cut down on a lot of this situations with these kids and how they're brought here like him, and trying to help other African kids when they come to America and not have to go through the struggle that he went through, being homeless for 4 months, 5 months, sleeping in a car, lived in 5 or 6 different homes across America, people just passing him on. Just a really sad story of what he went through.
Okay. Question is, from a coaching standpoint, what is a coaching mistake memory that stands out for you?
Wow, whew, good question. It's been a bunch, but probably the first time as a head coach. You know, I had somebody ask me that question the other day, and I think the biggest thing is a coaching mistake memory for me is just learning to go from being an assistant as the good guy and the encourager to being the decision maker as the CEO. And I think with that, I had a kid named Hassan Whiteside, who's an NBA player. And with that, it was the hardest thing of a really talented player who was a first round draft pick and who didn't practice hard, who wasn't working all the time, how to discipline him now as the head coach. And so with that, that was the biggest struggle for me early on, to not lose my team as a first year head coach, because he wasn't doing the things that the other ones should be doing. Got it. And how was I going to hold him accountable?
Yeah. So how'd you do it?
Well, I did. I set him down. I tried to talk to him. I tried to really put other people on the phone, Joe Kim Noah, Al Horford, to try to teach him what it looked like, another voice, and how to get there, and the way he was doing there, just trying to create change with him by buy-in. And so the only way I could get him to buy in and believe in was to take away what he wanted to do. So the first 7 games, he come off the bench. And when he did what was required, he played. When he didn't, I set him. And so that was very hard, because you're worried your best player would transfer. But he didn't. The buy-in worked, and he went on to have a phenomenal year.
Okay. So Billy Donovan is one of your closer friends. So what are the one or two things that you learned from Billy that you continue to take forward with your own teams?
Yeah, Billy Donovan's got an incredible ability to see everybody as a teacher, Scott. So it doesn't matter if it's the cleaning lady after a game, he's sitting in the office, he'll say, "What'd you think of our team tonight?" And she may say, "Coach, your boys didn't play very hard." He's able to listen and make everybody feel a part of what's going on, to add value and listen humbly. It doesn't matter who it is. He learns from you. He's a constant learner, and he's always looking for a better way to do what he does. So he changes with the times. The second thing is, Billy's got an incredible ability to be in the moment. He's got a vision and a focus and a memory like none other. So he can be locked in, and he's got the ability with that mentally to get you to lock in and play. He can take you to a place that you never could get yourself. Buying into him with how he can share love, share, and care. You know, he's got a gift for those three things to get people to want to be there and get better. He can transform people.
All right. Well, we got someone who's going to put you on the spot. We have 5 minutes left. And here's the question for Donnie. It says, in 2 minutes, share your 5 H's.
My five H's. Okay. Five H's. Wow. Okay, good. That's just pretty easy. I've did it for about 25 years.
You're teaching us, because I've also got some folks going, I got to do the five H's. So you're already making an impact.
Okay, good. All right. Well, my H is real quick. From a small town, Point Pleasant, West Virginia. Grew up about 6,000 people. Had incredible parents. Mom worked in a grocery store. My dad was a factory worker for Goodyear Tire and Rubber. I had a brother and sister. Had great family around me all the time, a community that loved me, support me, cheered me on. My hero growing up were obviously my parents. My dad was an incredible leader as a person. My mom is just an incredible worker, a loving mother, served and give to everybody. My highlight or my heartbreak, I lost my brother when I was 20 years old. He got killed in a car accident by a drunk driver. That was probably the hardest moment for me. The highlight for me was when I got a college scholarship right off. That was a big highlight as a kid. But being older, we have several highlights. So obviously meeting my wife, seeing my children born, winning national championships, just being a part of helping now as a head coach, helping other kids reach their dreams. And then my hope, my hope is to impact people. This is a platform for me. I try to do them one player at a time. I just don't want to impact 13 people. I'd love to impact a million people. Yeah, but I know the power of doing that one at a time. So that's my five H's. I think I got it in a little bit over a minute, Scott.
You did. You did a nice job. I think you've given a good sample for us for us to follow and do our own five H's. I'm probably going to do that with my staff. I have a staff. So for staff, we'll probably do that tomorrow at our staff meeting. So, Donnie, thank you for being here.
Thank you.
So, just thank you for your friendship. Thank you for being a blessing, to those of us who were able to hear from you today. And certainly good luck for the rest of the season. For those listeners who are on, next week will be our last one. People are going back to work. So our last Wednesday will be next Wednesday. And then we're going to go to monthly. So feedback has been really strong on it. So we're going to do it once a month. But the weekly ones, next week, Wednesday, will be the last. But the good news there is we're all going back to work. So Donnie, close us out. Just a couple things to share and then we're done.
Yeah. Well, I think the, couple things, Scott, this was a great one the other day. A lot of people were asking, how could this happen to us, the virus and everything we're going through, the players. I hear this all the time. And a great quote, what God doesn't prevent, he uses to promote. And I think, during this time that, our players are wondering, why is this happening? So how do we deal with this? And so I think, during this time, obviously communicating relationships, and we talk about winning the weight right now, Scott. How are we getting better? How are we growing each other as people? And how are we continuing to really use this time to promote and grow and become better through this time?
Okay. Donnie Jones, thank you very much. Thank you to those who took time out of your day to join us. And so enjoy the sunshine. Get out if you've got sunshine like we do in Michigan. And we'll look forward to seeing you next week. So take care.
Thank you.